and
so I'm just recording. Hope that's fine, right?
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah, no problem.
So since we've heard about Arohi so much from Sahil and his mom, we thought we'll reach out to you guys and see how this works out for both of us.
Yeah, sure. Yes.
Did I say?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'm Saurav and I live in Bangalore. I have two kids. One is a 10-year-old boy and a 5-year-old daughter. So, I personally, I am very much impressed with the idea of unconventional and not going into a conventional schools because of some of the issues and problem areas with that. So I have been contemplating different form of education for my kids, but currently as of now they go in conventional schools. So as a family we are still not out of that mode that we could take that decision. So on and off, I keep connecting with people in this area, mostly with the Arohi. They have been most supporting all the time. I've been in doubt. So the last 2 years has taught us a lot. It was a kind of home education only. So I don't know how can I take a decision to actually go full on unschooling or open learning or an environment where I can put my kids where they can explore life in its original way. But that is what I'm facing the issue, how to take that final step as a family. And moreover, I realized that if the kids or a family is not ready for this step, personally, I feel motivated myself to do something in this area because I feel very sad about the conventional schools and in the way they have taken things for granted and making commercialization in the education. So that thing is little, it hurts me, but the problem is that I myself is not able to take that final step. So it's a kind of a dilemma I'm going through. So I'm again trying to connect with ROE, get myself motivated, and let's see how it goes.
Good to see Saurav again. I'm back. Yeah, so just to introduce myself, I'm part of Arohi. I am since 6 years, and my child was also part of Arohi since he was 5 years old. Presently, he's doing his football. He wants to deep dive into football, and so he has joined clubs, and he was part of Arohi last 14 years, and recently he has started joining a club, and then he's undergoing training with the clubs. For me, to be very frank, this open learning for myself, it was just a life-changing, I can say. The way I was before the 6 years, and I joined for my child, but the whole benefit is for me. And I can see myself a drastic change in my way of living, my way of thinking, my way of taking any opportunities, struggles. Everything is a big change, what I could say. Today Ratnesh is traveling, so that's how he is not there. Usually Ratnesh takes this session. So I am taking on his behalf today. Yeah, it's open learning is wonderful for each one of us, and that's the whole motto for Aurahees. We say that every child needs this gift of doing their open learning. Who are we to decide what the child wants to learn? That is what we say. And the main core of our philosophy is just follow the child. Yeah, that's about us. So today in the session, I'll just go through a quick intro about Aurahee and open learning, and then we can take your doubts or whatever is your thoughts about education and all that. And then we'll, how do we connect more? All the details we can share it in the I'll share it in the last. Yeah. So today the education, many people call it as open learning, schooling, unschooling, free schooling. There are so many different names actually, if you see. But for us, it is all we call it as education is, it is open learning, as open as world for us to explore. So there is no structure, no curriculum. Whatever the child chooses is the curriculum for the child. So everything under the sky is our curriculum for the child. And the child is free to choose whatever he wants to learn or she wants to learn. That is what we say about education. So it is completely child-driven at Aurahee. And the child decides what to learn, how to learn, and how much to learn. So what is the purpose of education? If we see the purpose of late, if you see the purpose of education, it is mainly the education is learning to earn. That is what we see the purpose of education of late, what has changed. But what we believe is the purpose of education is mainly to live. So to live means to enjoy every moment of our life and to learn from that moment, whatever we are facing through, whatever we are struggling, whatever we are experiencing, all this is part of learning for us. So that is what we think about our education. Hi, Dwiji. Okay, Dwiji is also part of Aurahee. One of the parents, So what we say is, by the time Dwiji connects, I'll just move ahead. And we believe in Aurahee, the child is the leader for himself. He is the one who can drive his life, and he is the one who can drive his education. He is the one who can choose what he wants to learn and what he wants to become. Nobody can, in the name of a curriculum, in the name of a syllabus, we can't restrict the child of what to learn and how much to learn. Once the child is interested in learning whatever he wants to learn, there is nobody to stop the child, and the child will figure out what he wants to learn, from whom he wants to learn, all that the child figures out. And if he needs support, if he needs any guidance, the whole world is there for the child, open to help and to seek. This is the experience what we have been seeing in our open learning community, where the child seeks for the support, and then only we are not here to teach the child, but we are here to support the child when he is needed. This is one of the things what we keep saying. So the child is capable of deciding. Most of us would have experienced, if you have from the 0 to 2 years, you would have seen the child, whatever he wants to do, we just let the child to do. We can't make the child to do what we want at that time. So they are that is one of the things where we see that the child is an open learner at the start, and then we bind them into the school curriculum and so many different things. And then after a few years, then we start doing unlearning of ourselves, and we learn what we want to learn. Yeah, And then mainly at our philosophy is not to proactively teach the child. So we all see that we have been experiencing that every child is capable of figuring out different ways of learning, what they want to learn. And when they need something and when they want to learn, they are open to seek help. They are open to learn from anyone. They are open to ask. So this is what we have been seeing. When the child asks support, if he wants to teach, we can teach. If he wants us to guide, we can guide. And if he wants just to mentor us, we can mentor them. And we have been experiencing my child. He was an open learner. And he was throughout the 14, 15 years, he was following the open learning. And now he is deep into football. And now he is going the structured learning. So he likes that structure. He likes that commitment. He likes to be on time. And also he had not been for any schools, only he had done his LKG, and now he has been he wants to do his NIOS. The complete decision of NIOS he has taken, and he wants to read, and also he chose for that, I want teaching for this. I had never been for school and I want to learn the way it has to be taught. So I want to be taught. So he decided, and he is now planning to take up his exams next year. So he is going for a classes. So he wants to do that. So, and in football also, he has decided which club he wants to go for. And he decided the gym. Yes, now it is 17 years. I'm able to go for gym and I can take care of, I need to take care of my body. So he decides and he chooses, this is where I want to go. So it is after choosing everything, then he tells, Mom, I want to go for this gym. Mom, I want to join this class. Mom, I want to do this. And I have to just support him in those terms. That is what I have been experiencing. Did you want to add something? Yeah. So we also say that who are we to assess the child? When the child is capable of self-assessing, whatever the child is doing, when the child needs, okay, Mom, I have done this. When the child can do the self-assessment, child can do the self-reflection. And also we see that there is a great understanding when the child assesses for themselves. So the child comes and says, see, this is what I have cooked today. And I think there is something I have made a mistake. And this is what I have done the mistake. And this is how it has turned to be. The child, when he is reflecting about the learning, the child is telling the whole story about why it went wrong, how it went wrong, and what is the learning from that mistake. And there is a beautiful learning in that when the child assesses himself. And also it is not only that when the child feels, okay, now it is ready for me to ask my peer feedback. Hey, I have done this. How is that? And what is that your taste? And how is it? So one of the child, what we have experienced is he was very much interested in baking. And this child makes a delicious cake and he likes sweet very much. And he adds more of sugar in that. And then he finds it very tasty. And this child gives the cake to the friends and he says, how's the cake? And he seeks feedback because he wants to do it, take it further ahead. So then he gets the response, it is too sweet. And then he gets adult is also there. And when he asks, auntie, how is it? He is taking feedback from every one of us. And then the auntie says, see, there are many people who like sweet too much. There are people who don't like sweet too much. There are people who like moderate sweet. So if you want to be a baker, you need to understand the kind of which can be moderate and suit to everyone. So that was the feedback which the child has taken. And now he is trying to understand how to make it. He likes all these different flavors and all that. So he started buying that. Then we read with the child that if you are adding these flavors, how is it going to affect this in our health? And if you want the customers who are looking in the terms of health, so then how do you deal with these customers? So we have been together in the journey with the child, and the child wants to try, presently the child has done his 10th and he wants to go to one particular institute of hotel management, and that needs a degree. So he is planning for his degree for undergoing the training in that particular hotel management institute. So we also say we are imposing the child's career by the school or college or the certificate as the only way for having a successful or happy life. When the child can find his own path to his career or to his life, why are we restricting only one way, that degrees only can give the successful life for the child? There are n number of ways where we have been experiencing, we have been seeing people who are successful without degrees, who are self learners. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So my son is telling I am too loud, I need to speak little low. So is this volume fine? Okay. Yeah. So there are n number of ways where the child can decide to do his self-learning. The child learns from apprenticeship. The child learns through open courses. And even till date, we all have been learning many, many different things in our own ways. Some by getting the guidance, some by learning by ourselves, some by trying, experimenting. In fact, Dviji is an open learner. Dviji, you want to share about yourself? Can't hear you, Tiji.
Better now.
Little cracking.
Yeah. Is it better now? Yeah. So I will think that we'll come back.
Background sound is there, Tiji.
No, this is better.
Some background sound is there. Okay, fine.
What?
Yes, Dviji has into millets, and also Dviji, also he's a self-learner in terms of machines, in terms of tools, understanding of tools and all these. So he has done his open learning journey, and still it is little cracking. Maybe
I lost my phone. Yeah, thank you so much. Okay. The presentation.
No, Dviji, we can't hear you.
Is it better? No.
Okay, fine, I'll take it. No issues. Yeah. So, there is a video to play about the Arohi. But right now I'm not playing. There is some issue with my system and I play it hangs. So this is about Arohi, where everyone is open to explore, experiment, and do whatever they wish to do. That is the whole video. I can send the link later. So here what we say is there is no age bar. We don't have any child or an adult concept. We all are equal. So when this is what we say with the child is beautifully taking all kinds of responsibility for himself or herself. Every child is capable of taking their own responsibility, their safety. We have been doing traveling with children, where children take us to the entire trip, take the entire responsibility of the trip, where to go they plan and how to go they plan, how much to spend they plan, what to eat they plan, and where to stay they plan. So every entire responsibility is led by the children. This is what we have been experiencing. So every child is capable when we allow the child to explore, when we allow the child to experiment, and when we allow the child to take the responsibility. Let me see if it goes. If it I think it's loading. Okay, in the meantime, when it is loading, can you hear the sound? Deepa, can you hear the sound?
Oh, very mild.
Sorry?
Very faint, very faint sound.
Okay, I'll skip that video. So, with respect to that, what we say is it's not one person can take the child's responsibility. It takes a whole village to raise a child. So, every person, everything, whatever the child interacts, there is a learning from every thing, whatever the child interacts. And that's how this quote says that it takes a whole village to raise the child. So over to your questions. If you have some questions, Sonia, about education, about learning, you can share. So...
Can I ask something?
Yes, yes, Deepa.
So, Leela, you were talking about how your son decided after open schooling to then go into the regular education system because he wanted it.
Okay.
So, how difficult do these kids find themselves, when they start going into conventional education again?
I don't see there is a difficulty in the way the child, when he decides he wants to take up, there was no difficulty. But it takes he was not into the practice of reading or writing. So it took him little time for him to get into the groove of, okay, I need to read and I need to do that. Once the mindset is done, then the child is ready for reading. Today, he says, okay, I need to send something to my sir. So I need to read for that. So he knows the purpose that why he needs to read, why he needs to write exam. So all this, his intention is clear that I want to do this because of this. So he is ready to take that effort. Yes, the child initially he finds it difficult, but once the mindset is ready, then it is easy going for the child to take it. We need to give that little time for the child to go through that and the support.
I'm also dying to know which football club he's joined because my family is totally into football.
Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah. So he's going to BUFC, Bangalore United Football Club. It's close to HAL.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Can you give more clarity on how the National Open School works?
NIOS, it is open all over the world. So anybody can take up this NIOS. So any child who is above 14 can register. And the entire syllabus, then there is coaching centers, all that it is there for children to take over. It is accepted all over.
Okay, so like even children who are in ROE sign up for NIOS after 14, or then they have to, if they want to do NIOS, they have to do it on their own.
Only if the child decides he wants to take up 10th, then the child goes for the 10th. if you see Ratnesh's daughter, she did not want to take up pen, and she's 23 years old, and the entire her journey she has been exploring, experimenting, and she is into the sustainable world, and she does all the she started her own business of chemical free world, where she makes her own homemade products like soaps, like tooth powder, all these kind of things. Even soap she has started making, and all this she's been running us with business, and she is a self-taught business entrepreneur. So she has been exploring. She also explored art, dance, and you name it. She whatever she finds new and interesting, she tries out that. So she's been full-time explorer, and she's been learning through experimentation.
You have a residential program, right? Where you were saying that Bangalore children go during weekends. So that's a residential program. Correct.
Yes.
And is there any particular time you can join, or you can join anytime? How does it work?
Yes, it is open. Anytime anybody can join. There is nothing like as in schools, the restricted time, like you need to join in the start of the year, something like that. Any family decides that they want to explore at the open learning, yes, you are free to do so.
So suppose the child is very interested in, say, science and social, but they don't want to do any other subject. So how does something like that work out in ROE?
For us, everything under the sky is a subject. Everything under the sky is subject for us. Like how the child took up the cooking, he was actually 6 hours he used to do cooking without any hesitation, without anything. Similarly, when the child decides to do science, the child, science is not one particular thing, one is the subject. There are so many different things that the child can explore in science. So exploring, experimenting, everything is open for the child. The child can choose how to explore and what to explore. Nature, it could be animals, it could be with physics, it could be with chemicals. Everything is open for the child to explore.
Hello, Leela. My name is Karthik. Sorry, I joined late due to some internet issues.
Okay, no issues, Karthik.
Hello. Hi, everyone.
Hi.
So I had a question. What is the sort of starting age limit that can like sort of be exposed to open schooling at Arohi? My daughter is 2 years old, so I was just thinking if I could bring her along or not, because to take care again, it will be a different effort, right? So.
Okay. So what we say here is 0 to 99 is the age limit for anyone to join campus.
Oh. 99 is a bit young.
Sorry?
99 years is a bit young, right?
Yeah. As old as 0 years and as young as 99 years.
Yeah, right.
We say 0 to 2 is the perfect age where the child is already an open learner. So.
Right.
Yeah, we have to just give that support for the child to be the open learner in the life throughout.
So I was thinking if there is like how the care can be provided for such a young kid.
Sorry?
Like, for example, if I'm involved in some activity, or my wife, if we come, will be involved in some other activity, like how what would be a day look like is what I want to understand.
Okay. So it is you're asking how the day at campus looks like?
Yes, I read some things online. So yeah. Where it was mentioned that we would be assigned different tasks or... not tasks, but we can volunteer to do so many things and all. So I was thinking if how the young kid could sort of get in the flow of this.
Yes. See, 2 years old, we can't tell what the child wants to do. The child is already deciding what he wants to do.
Right.
It is only an adult being around for the safety of the child. That's all. And you can decide along whatever the child is doing. You can decide something to do in those areas which you can explore. Mainly one of them can be part of the session. The other can be part of the session too, even if the child is interested in different things. But be around the space where the child is.
Okay.
So we accommodate all age children. There are people who
with
the child, 6 months old, 1 year old, 2 year old, all age children we have been. They are part of campus.
Can I ask?
Yes.
Sure, sure.
No, Karthik, continue. Let's finish your then.
Is there any sports facilities like playground and like the slides and swings and such things? Or
yes, yes. If you want all those, you can also come and make it, Karthik. We are open for that. We already have. Yeah, if you want to add more, you can definitely add more.
Oh, okay.
Leela,
yes, Deepa.
When can we come and see the campus? And
presently, due to this pandemic, we have made the process. Earlier, it was open for anyone to just visit, just register or just call up that we want to visit. It was open for everyone. Right now, due to this pandemic, we have made a small process. If you visit the webpage, what is the process? It is given in details. First is they need to, whoever is keen on understanding open learning and to experience that, they are all welcome. And there is a registration form over there. You can fill the form. And once you are done, then we will give an orientation about campus and campus safety. And once you attend that, you can join the campus. You can visit the campus. And we prefer that it will be people to stay at least for a week from Monday to Friday, where it easily takes time for anyone to get adjusted to the environment for the first 2 days and then to experience the learning process and the environment, to learn from the environment. So all this, it takes time to soak. So we always say, like in the video, as you see, that go slow. It takes time for anyone to just soak in that environment. So that is why we prefer to be there for the entire 5 days.
But Leela, given the fact that the child is currently in a conventional school and has to attend class, are you all open to the 5 days being in during the vacations, or are you all closed for vacation?
Next week is a break week for campus. Otherwise, it was open. So you can, there is a calendar also there. So you can check the holidays, like your child's holiday or your free time, and how as a family you want to make yourself free for that whole week. You can plan and you can check the calendar and you can register for the same dates.
Leela, how many kids are there presently in Arohi, permanent?
Presently, there are around 12 children. Before the pandemic, there were around 20 children.
12 from Bangalore or 12? Anybody staying there? Like from other states?
So these 12 children are regular children. So they come and some are from different state also.
Okay, so some students are staying there on Saturdays and Sundays, right?
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay. Hi, am I audible now?
Yes, Dviji, you are much better. Yes, your voice is back.
Finally. I lost my mobile, my mobile got stolen today when I was coming back. So I'm without my primary device and my laptop has some audio issues. So this is my desktop, which doesn't have a video camera. So apologies to everyone. Just to reorient the conversation a little bit, not that we were drifting in a different direction, but just that the whole idea of this meetup is to talk about open learning, not just about Arohi, but rather about open learning as a concept, as a practice, as a way of living. And Arohi is just one part of open learning. So let us not feel that we at Arohi feel that whatever we do is open learning and what others do is not open learning. No, that's not at all the case. So let's also, you know, kind of zoom out a little bit from Arohi itself, because I remember in the introductions, Deepa and Dilip had some, you know, they have some experiences with learning outside of the conventional system as well. Sorry, Saurabh and Dilip shared something, and Deepa was curious to know a few things about open learning as a concept. So just, I would like the conversation to zoom out a little bit, and then maybe we can come back to a little more focused discussion on how Arohi works and how things work at Arohi. Yeah. So just a couple of things. I mean, I heard some of the conversation earlier. So my few comments about some of the things I heard. Deepa, the point is that when a child joins Arohi, they do whatever they do. It's not just when they take NIOS. So even when they're not signing up for NIOS, they are structuring their learning experience. They are finding the resources and they are doing it. So literally they take ownership of it. Like Leela was sharing, Drupad took ownership of his learning. So his football, he wanted coaching. So he went for coaching. He would like to do certain things. So he's going for classes for certain things. So the idea of open learning and taking ownership go hand in hand, whether you take NIOS or not take NIOS. So it's not that NIOS children are left out in the sea on campus and the other children are, you know, part of a ship. Everyone's in their own ship. And Arohi is a community where we are trying to get these ships to, you know, interact and build a community. And these ships are not just, you know, children. Like Saurabh was sharing, and you know, like Leela and I are living examples of that. We have been practicing open learning in our own lives, different periods of time, and in different ways. Not necessarily the same way that you know, we at Arohi practice things today. But when we do it as a community, there are multiple resources available. Different interests that are available, different skill sets that are available for everyone else to tap into, to harness, to use, to, you know, to learn from. So that's the idea of open learning in a community, rather than open learning by ourselves in a, you know, in a home environment or in a isolated, you know, by ourselves family environment. So that's one important point that I felt I should put across. And I would also like to take a minute to just share a little bit about what we had put out as the theme for today, which is that how do open learners deal with the I, me, myself, and then move to the, or, you know, build up to the we and us phase. And this is very important because I mean, like most of us feel, would have realized when we look at our own lives, very rarely do we do things by ourselves. Most of the time we are interacting with others and working in as part of teams. And also in terms of, you know, living in a society, in a community. So the whole idea of open learning as we practice it in Arohi is to look at living and learning, but together in a community, not just isolated, living on one side, learning on another side. You know, to live, you go to the world, you do your work and you do things. To learn, you go to school or you go to college or you go do a coursework. No, that's not the way we look at it. We look at both living and learning as a continuous intersection and a crisscrossing path, and probably even a single path, I should say. And therefore, the idea of I, me, myself, being conscious of who I am, what I can do, cannot do, all these aspects become very important, we feel, because we are trying to relate to one another. And this aspect we bring in from a very early stage, as soon as we start the open learning process. So therefore, we feel that open learning kind of gets us ready for the world way better than conventional education does. Does it give us all the tools? Probably not. But then conventional education doesn't give us all the tools either, because most of the time we as adults in our own adult life, we have barely used what we did in our colleges or schools directly, I mean. So broadly speaking, the idea of open learning and this consciousness about I, me, myself, and the we and us is very deep rooted in what we do and what we believe. And I felt that's a very, very important aspect that doesn't get noticed often enough. So that we put out as the theme for the day. So if you have any thoughts or questions or experiences of your own to share about these things, that would be very much appreciated. But if you don't and you would like to ask some other questions, you would like to share some other experiences, you're please welcome to. You can chat, unmute. There's just 5-6 of us. So you can unmute yourself and speak, or feel free to chat, type out in the chat window. And we also have Karthik who has joined us. Yes. Karthik, would you like to come online and just share a few words about yourself?
He did.
Oh, he did. Oh, sorry. I missed it in my transition. Yeah, sorry.
Yeah. No problem. Yeah, I joined a bit late because I had some internet issues.
No issues. I mean, I've been fighting with the same myself. So let's move on. Leela, do you want to take out the presentation so that we can have a gallery view?
Yeah, sure, Nandiji.
Thank you. Yeah. So please, folks, I'm sorry, my video is, I don't have my video camera, but let's continue the conversation.
Yeah, we saw you, Dviji, before. Over to you. Any more questions you would like to ask about open learning? We all are here.
I just want to know one question. Is like NIOS sort of the default board for taking up these exams, or are there any other, or do you feel that NIOS exams are necessary to certify it, or what is your take on that?
Leela, you're muted.
Okay, yeah. Like previously I said that this is only the child decides. When the child feels that it is important, I'm not here to decide for the child. So when the child decides that he wants to do 10th, and then we go for the NIOS. Otherwise, there are children who are not doing their 10th. Some of the children, they are not doing their 10th. Like as I shared, Ratnesh's daughter is not taken 10th. And his son also has not taken 10th.
So... Karthik, NIOS is not the only option. There are other options too. Like the Karnataka State Education Board allows you to appear for the 10th standard exam if you apply as a private candidate.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. They have some requirements. So you have to start, you'll have to check it out. And yeah. Okay. I believe CBSE also allows for private candidates. I'm not sure about that. So NIOS is not the only option. Other than that, there are also these international curricula.
Yes,
IGCSE.
Yes.
Where you can appear for the exams without going through any schooling as such.
Yes.
So NIOS is not the only option.
Okay.
But is NIOS enough for applying in colleges in India?
It's overall, it's accepted, Dilip.
Okay.
So the question of acceptability, you know, is a bit of a, actually, let's not get into that. The bigger point that I would like to share here is that when we are thinking of open learning, we are not thinking of an alternative schooling. Somehow I have this feeling in this conversation that we are looking at open learning as an alternative to conventional schooling. No, it's an entirely different thing where you question the very need to school someone. Right? We are saying that the child can identify what they want to do and they will excel in what they want to do, given adequate space and opportunities and resources. And as facilitators, as guardians, as parents, our role is to create that ground where they can flourish. Like Deepa was sharing earlier, identify the talents that they have and nurture those talents and nurture those instincts and see how we can, what kind of resources, what kind of opportunities can we create for these children and for ourselves. That's the other thing. Let's not think that open learning is only for children. Like Saurabh shared, some of us are more motivated than our children when it comes to, an open learning community. So the idea of open learning is not just if not school, then open learning. No. It's like if living, then open learning.
Truly, I agree with you. Truly.
But Leela, when your son had to go join the regular college, they do ask for some mark sheets and passing outs and things like that, right?
He's not still part of the regular schooling. He is only taking up the 10th exams.
Okay, he's...
Yeah, okay. But otherwise also there are many children who have... who were part of the alternate learning, they wanted to join school, so they were able to join school.
And Deepa,
like any year in between, they were able to go back to
school. Every school has a kind of a written test or something like that, which when the child decides that he wants to do the regular schooling, so the child will be taken a test. So when now the child is prepared that he wants to do that, and then he can prepare for it. And then there are many people who have done that also, few children.
Yeah, and Deepa, I would like to add that, we as much as we challenge schools and schooling, we also challenge colleging, where we work according to a curriculum. Because one of the things that we see more and more in the the working environment these days, if you look at especially post-COVID, one of the words that they are talking about is hybrid skills, where you have a core competency, but it's not just your core competency that your employer is looking for, but these other subsidiary skills which the company or the organization can harness. And we do this every time in our lives, right? I mean, it's not like if I'm an engineer, I'll only do what, or if I'm a software engineer, I don't just do software engineering. I do some bit of management, I do some bit of admin, I do some bit of communications, I do a lot of other things. So in that sense, what we are seeing more and more is that conventional education, whether it is schooling or colleging, especially colleges, are coming up really short when it comes to skill sets that are required in the workplace or even in businesses, right? Especially if you have a business of your own, we recognize more and more that the MBAs are not coming out the way the schools intend them to be. So what we are looking at is that philosophically, we feel that each one of us is capable of learning. And we need to sharpen those skills as we grow. And the more we are able to pick up ourselves and learn new things, the better off we will be in the near, short-term, long-term future. Because the nature of the game is to be ready to change and evolve, right? I mean, largely ecologically speaking as well, especially with all the, the kind of things that are happening globally with climate crisis and economic crisis and all that. So being ready for change is best when you are ready for change, even when you're younger. And as open learners, we encourage children to not just do one thing, but expose them to many things.
Yeah.
Through this activities and interactions in the community. And therefore, if a child chooses to do one particular thing, let's say maths or embroidery or construction or electrical wiring stuff, they are really into it. If they are not motivated, they're not going to continue doing it because there are tons of things happening on campus in the community. So our idea of looking at college and schooling is not from a perspective of requirement, as looking at it as a requirement. No, we do not consider that as a requirement. It's an option that is also available. But we are really not grooming our children to become college students or score A plus or 4.0 GPA. If that makes sense.
Yeah.
A lot of it does. Thanks to
the sorry, I might be coming across a little aggressive here, but it's just that the way we look at it is not from the perspective of will they fit into college or will they fit into school. We have seen children fit in everywhere,
That's reassuring, because though we are considering this open learning, we still are coming from the conventional and we are not yet integrated into your system.
Correct.
And so we have our doubts about how long are we going to last in this open learning system? Will we change our mind somewhere? And then how do we go back and integrate ourselves into the conventional system if the open learning system doesn't suit us? So that's where my whole questioning is from. Questions are coming from.
And this transition, whether out of conventional to open learning or from open learning back to conventional, will be more, smoother, not easier, but smoother when the person themselves is involved in those decisions. When the individual themselves is involved in those decisions.
Sorry to interrupt. I agree with you totally on that. But the fact of the matter is, say 6 months coming into open learning,
mm-hmm.
The child may get integrated to open learning, but the rest of the family may not feel that they are happy with the way things are going, let's say. And that at that point, the family is taking a decision of putting them back into conventional school, not the child, which is unfair, you may say, but like we all have to deal with our own issues. And at that point, how difficult it will be, especially the questions are coming from me in this mm-hmm. direction, because I'm not the biological child of the mother of the child, and the child has her biological mother.
Mm-hmm.
So I have to ask these questions because though I am the one who takes decisions regarding education about this child,
mm-hmm.
she still has her mother, and the mother has a say in how the child is going to shape up and hence, I have so many doubts about
it. Yeah. Completely agree. And that brings me, thank you for bringing this point up, because we always say a child does not join the community. It's the family that joins the community. So the exact point that you shared, or the concern that you shared. So we are looking at a family joining the community, and therefore, the buy-in has to be not just the child's. So I said it from the transition perspective and the ease of transition. But you know, that's from the child's perspective. But from the community's perspective, we are looking at families joining the community. So that's why I think Leela already mentioned that we would like families to visit campus, stay on campus for a week or a few weeks before they make their decision of whether they want to continue here or not. Right? So completely agree with you that the family has to buy into this. And it cannot be without the family's involvement. And given the scenario that you are living through right now and trying to, you know, work out something, it is going to be that much more challenging. And we as a community would be very much interested in, you know, supporting your explorations of open learning and try to see how we can get more, you know, expand the tribe, as they say, or grow the tribe. Yeah.
Thanks, Tej.
On an average, what would be the strength of or the number of students residing in Aravi campus?
So Karthik, it numbers vary, but first and foremost, there are no students in Aravi. There are only learners in Aravi.
Learners.
Because students has this thing about curriculum, students, teachers, and
right. That's the...
So sorry, I'm being a little anal there, but yeah. So on an average, like post COVID now, or I shouldn't say post COVID, but post lockdown now, we are running at maximum strength. So we are limited by the number of beds we have on campus, and the number that we feel is a safe, count to keep when it comes to safety from a pandemic perspective. We still feel that we are living through the pandemic. We are not yet out of it till, you know, some semblance of normalcy comes through. So right now we are limiting to 20 people on campus, plus some 5-6 local folks who work on campus. So that's the strength. And we are running at, you know, with a wait list now for the next few months. But overall, in terms of children, there are about 12 to 20.
But when pre-COVID, what was your full strength?
Yeah. So, Leela, you remember
the
numbers?
Yes, we had above 55 also, actually. One time we had, in summer camps, we do have children up to 50 on down.
But you have facility for 50 to stay on there?
Yes.
Yeah, it's a 5-acre campus. Okay. About 60 kilometers from Bangalore. Mm-hmm. And it's a very beautiful weather most of the year. And during summer camps, we have folks pitching tents and sleeping on terrace and, you know.
Yes, all options are
open.
Okay. How far is it from Hosur station?
Around 16 to 17 kilometers from Hosur.
And there is a railway station much closer also, about a mile, 1.5 kilometers from campus, which is Kelamangalam. And there are a few trains that go to that stop at Kelamangalam from Bangalore as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have to leave, guys. Thank you very much for the wonderful session and information.
You're welcome, Karthik. And just check out our website if you haven't already done so. And we have recordings of all these discussions. And earlier we had it in a webinar format. So we have a lot of families sharing their experiences of open learning. So just visit
the
our
mail
website.
What I got had the link for this YouTube collection.
It's there on the website.
Right.
If you just look out, you'll find those. Yeah.
Sure.
You can see like one of the video which I was just relating to Deepa's, where a 7-year-old decides that I want to do regular schooling, how a child from open learning decides to go for regular schooling, experiences, oh, this is not the kind of schooling I wanted, and then she comes back to the open learning. Where I didn't care. the entire decision, the entire journey was taken by the child and only the parents were supporting. So there are many beautiful journeys which has been shared in these webinars. So you can go through whenever at your time.
Sure, yeah.
So we will be around. So if folks want to continue the conversation, we are here for another 15-20 minutes at least.
Vijay,
I can be here for another 15-20 minutes. I don't know about Leela. So usually we say it's an hour, but we go beyond an hour typically. And so yeah, please. And if you have to get going, that's perfectly fine. You can come back any Saturday at 5 and we'll be on this Zoom link.
Okay, will it be there next Saturday since next week is off? Okay.
Sure. Okay. We'll be there.
So I'll just give Leela a call. Thanks.
Yes, sure, Karthik. There is one more new guest has joined along with Saurav.
Yeah.
Hi. Yeah, sure.
Dviji, Leela was telling us that you are also an open learner.
Yeah.
Do share with us when you joined and why you joined. And
well, see, Leela means it in the larger sense because I did my own, I mean, I didn't let my schooling affect my education. So as I was studying physics and all that comes with it, I did my PhD in mechanical engineering, but I kept working on my own stuff and learning my own things. And today I'm working on agriculture and technology and food and nutrition and soil and farming and a whole bunch of things, mainly in the intersections of technology and food and sustainability. And so I say I'm an open learner, and I am an open learner because without knowing the words open learning, that's exactly what I was doing. I would go to astronomy classes when I was in my 12th grade. And most of my summers and winter holidays were in some camp or the other to learn about, some microwave device or radio telescopes or stuff like that, or general theory of relativity and stuff like that. So by the time I did my master's, I was taking classes for bachelor's. And, substituting for professors, not just assistantships. And then I decided to do a PhD in mechanical engineering. And so from physics, I shifted to mechanical engineering. So today I can teach engineering to mechanical and civil engineers, but I can't become a member of Institute of Engineers in India because I don't have an engineering degree. So that's my open learning journey in a nutshell, and I continue learning new things and expanding the scope of my my horizons in some sense.
So are you part of the Arohi management? And
well, everybody in the community is part of the Arohi management. There is no there's no separation between you are a parent, I'm a manager, or I'm a facilitator. I just spent a week on campus, spending my time with the community there on campus, working on different things of my own interest as well as of the community's interest. And I spend a fair amount of time with the facilitators. We have three facilitators in the community, Leela, Ratnesh and Aditi. And it's not just the three folks who are, working on campus. Even the children on campus are working full time.
15 facilitators, sir, Vijay.
Yeah, well, that's true. I mean, as many people are there, that many facilitators are there on campus. So that's I'm sorry. I kind of missed that one. Thank you, Leela.
Yeah, in the community, we see children are taking up the jobs of accountants, children are taking up the managing the kitchen. So everyone in the community are part of making of community, creating codes for community and running the community.
Yeah, so you will find some who are more outspoken and some who are less outspoken. That's all.
But which we find anywhere, everywhere.
So. Exactly. I was about to say, you know, one of the things that I typically say in these, and probably if you browse through some of the recordings, you're bound to hear that open learners don't have horns or wings or, you know, tails or anything. They are normal human beings with the same failings and successes of every other human. So open learning does not give you wings or horns.
And it's as we say, that open learning doesn't come just with the freedom of what to do, but it also comes with the responsibility. It is as challenging as we any other thing, like open learning. It's not easy, but it's worth taking this journey.
So thank you so much. I will get going and I will try to fix a week where I can come with the child and explore your family and take
Lovely.
It from.
Lovely.
Thank you, Diji and Lita. Thank you so much.
Before we close, Deepa, we just wanted to say that Diji wanted to share that Arohi and Arohi X and Reese part.
You do the honors, please.
I. Yeah, so we also have Arohi campus open for people who want to visit. And we also have the Arohi extended at homes, which we join from many people who are not able to visit campus. They are joining from, especially in this pandemic, we started with the online also, where the families who are not able to visit campus, they have started their journey of homes, open learning from home. And we do have the same kind of a setup even in the online also. So it's open for both. Anything else, Kuchi?
So how would you go about the online open learning experience? Yeah.
That we would like to, there is another orientation if you want to understand about Arohi X, how it runs. So you can also relook into that. You can also see the website about Arohi X.
Arohi X, it's called.
Yeah, we call it as extended at homes. And we do have the Instagram, Telegram group, and on Facebook, if you want to know more about our open learning journey, which we have been posting and sharing our learning journeries there.
Are we open for, you mentioned that it's closed for the next week or coming week or next week?
11th to 15th is a break. I'm just seeing the calendar.
Yeah.
Thank you, Deepa. See, you're already a facilitator.
No, but that's my default setting also. I can't help it. I'm also looking forward to joining the community.
Lovely.
Definitely all are welcome.
Looking forward to it.
Thank you, everybody. See you again soon.
Thank you, Deepa. Bye. So, Sara,
bye.
If you would like to continue, we are available.
Come again, Dwij, Divi.
I said, if you would like to continue, we are around. But if you want to pause here, that's fine too.
Yeah, I would take a leave now.
Okay. But yeah, nice seeing you again, Sarah.
Thank you. I will plan to spend a week at Arohi.
So just go through the visit page and make sure you sign up for an orientation so that because of this pandemic, we have an additional, you know.
Yeah, I will take care of that. Yeah.
Even otherwise, we do ask for an orientation, but especially now with the COVID and all that. So.
Yeah.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you.
So Dilip, you said you're in Kerala, is it?
I'm in Kerala and I'm planning to visit Arohi on the 18th. I already got the confirmation.
Oh, good.
So we'll be meeting Leela there on the 18th.
Yeah, sure, Dilip. So maybe I'll be sending you the safety orientation link also. Hope you would have got that.
No, I have not got that because...
In the same email, it will be there. Confirmation of your visit.
The Thursday orientation is there.
Correct. That's the one.
Yes, Thursday at 8 o'clock.
Yeah.
That's the one.
meeting, so, you can join there.
I'll probably not be meeting you, Dilip, but I'm sure we will interact again sometime. So.
Yes.
Great. Okay. Thank you. Let's pause for today then. And
thank you.
Join us again on Saturday, just in case you have some last minute 11th hour butterflies or anything. So, great.
Bye. Bye, Bridgie. Good night.